When most of you this Christmas season turn your Christmas lights on, you probably just simply flip a switch. Well, that's not so for Hal Swindle. Hit it. Make no doubt about it, Harold Swindle loves Christmas. For almost 30 years, Swindle has been decorating his house with almost any kind of light that will burn. And folks from practically everywhere make their way to visit what's become a Cumberland County Christmas tradition.
I've never seen anything like it before in my life. And I'm 61 years old, but I have never seen nothing like this.
How would you describe it?
I don't know. I wouldn't know how to describe it. It's just beautiful.
This year, Swindle has some 150,000 lights strung from the house to the barn and anywhere else he could get them.
It's not Christmas. I got my lights. Gotta have them. We try to do a little better with it each year.
How do you get them up on the tree?
With a slingshot.
So it's kind of like Christmas year-round for you.
Yeah, well, it takes about all year round to do it. Used to, but it didn't take two or three months. But now we have to start in August putting them up. Then we have to start in May and June checking them out.
The Swindle home is located on Highway 69 between Arab and Cumberland, and the lights come on every night at dark. There is no charge. Near Cumberland, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
I'm an old bachelor, and I live by myself. All the bread and cheese I get, I put them on the shelf. The rats and the mice have made such trouble, I had to go to London to get me a wife.
71-year-old Lucian Boyd has no complaints whatsoever. Having called home Old Bucks Mill in Lincoln County, Tennessee, the past 19 years, Boyd and his dogs appear to be perfectly content. Blessed with a little music ability, Boyd started blowing on the French harp when he was 9 years old. Today, Boyd considers himself a pretty good harmonica player. However, at times, the dogs do seem to disagree.
Well, I ain't the best, but I'm up in the top 20, I reckon.
Here's a special treat for you, Jingle Bells on the harmonica. In Lincoln County, Tennessee, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper. Merry Christmas. The 57 T-Bird is a classic automobile, and for Bernard Andrews, the Thunderbird is a part-time occupation. Andrews, a classic car enthusiast, is the proud owner of not one, but three Thunderbirds, all valued at around $10,000 to $11,000, and each for sale. Andrews's 56 and 57 T-Birds are no doubt one-of-a-kind cars, but they're nothing like the white 55 Thunderbird that outshines them all, literally. Andrews always wanted a car that would really show up, and now with 200 feet of Christmas lights attached to just about everywhere, Andrews has one unusual Christmas decoration.
I thought it'd be something different and wanted to know what it'd look like, and then after we did it, we liked it, so we bought some more lights and put more on it. There were only 3 years of this particular body style, that is the two-passenger car, and there weren't very many of them made.
So it's a classic, right?
Well, it's a special interest auto.
How do you think it looks as a Christmas ornament?
I think it'd look great under somebody's Christmas tree.
The Thunderbirds here of Bernard Andrews were made to be flashy automobiles, but I don't know if this is quite what Ford had in mind. In Big Cove, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
Up this old hair, the Christmas fair, spreading the good news everywhere about Christmas time and what it means to all the children of the world. Every little boy and girl out there loves this old man.
I tell you, the things I enjoy the most, Jamie, is the way, is thinking about the way it used to be back home. And my mother gave me something for my birthday, which is, it used to be when I was home. Birthday.
Well, happy birthday.
Birthday and Christmas was the same gift. Luckily, it's not that way anymore, but my parents had it made with me because they could give me one gift for both. And then she gave me, when I was growing up, we didn't have enough money for me to afford a haircut. It's kind of a habit for me, you know, because...
Still don't.
But anyway, she cut my hair in those days. And we had a fight every time it was time to have a haircut because she pulled my hair, you know. But what she gave me for my birthday was the old clippers that she used to cut my hair after 20 or 25 years. And I'm not so sure that having everything for Christmas is something to be as thankful for as maybe just being happy and healthy and being together as a family and like I was when I was a kid. I thought then it was awful, but now I think it was pretty good.
Everybody from the Alabama Christmas party.
Are you sweating?
I'm sweating a whole lot with the sweatshirt on these long johns. Look what I got on. Let's hurry up and say Merry Christmas, everybody, where I can get this over with. Look at the camera, everybody. Merry Christmas. Y'all say it on a 1, 2, 3?
I watch the weather sometimes, too.
Don't. 1, 2, 3.
Merry Christmas.
I said I didn't have much, but what I had was for sale, cash or credit.
That was the general feeling among all those who found their way to the Lacon Trade Day, a flea market of sorts that for years has been the place to be on a Saturday morning. For those with no better place to be, the Lacon Trade Day offers a unique selection of items to choose from. Just ask Paul Owens. He claims he's here every Saturday.
Lacon, ain't many places got stuff like Lacon's got. People all over Alabama ought to come and come. Look here. I even got a homemade sledgehammer. That come over here from Germany.
Yeah. Now, I will be the first to admit that never have I been to a place where the most talked about item has been dead for days.
What do you take for a dead beaver?
I'd take $20 for him. Who you give?
$20 for him?
From dead beavers to hunting dogs, the Lacon offers a wide variety of animals. $5 for some of these to $250 and $500 for these.
What's a good rooster go for over here?
Oh, about $15, $20. If you got a good one, if it ain't okay, you might well leave it at home.
Y'all aren't chicken fighters, are you?
No, sir. We're just out trying to make a dollar or two.
Yeah, we're fighting them every once in a while.
Well, you think that's a good deal, $20 for that dead beaver?
Well, I guess if a man like dead beavers.
So if a man like dead beavers, $20 would be a steal.
It'd be a steal, sir.
The Lake God Trade Day, have your catcher over, J.B. Cooper. What would you do with a dead beaver?
When it comes time to find a bargain, most folks will go just about anywhere to save a few pennies, including an abandoned, dirt-floor, red-painted chicken house on the outskirts of Grant.
I got a hundred to bid two. I got two to bid three. I got two to bid three. And about a quarter to bid a half.
They've been gathering here every Friday and Saturday night for the past 14 years, each with an eye toward the merchandise and an ear lent to the auctioneer.
I got 26 to bid 27. I got 27 to bid 28. I got 27 to bid 28. Anybody to bid 28? I got 28.
Anything is legal. We got any kind of merchandise we want most of the time.
Any kind?
Any kind. Anything is legal, I'll sell it. They bring a goat in the door, I'll sell it. They can get it on tape.
Looking more like a place you could find the elusive herb, the Chicken House Auction offers a variety of items from house shoes to heaters. But most importantly, this auction house offers a form of entertainment that only these folks could appreciate.
The ladies come out here, have some place to go, get a goodbye, and talk, you know, talk with other people around them, people they ain't seen in a long time.
I just come for the fun of it.
Thank you.
I come whether I buy anything or not.
Hamburger's pretty good?
Yeah, boy, I mean, they're good.
Now, I'm not saying you'll find exactly what you're looking for here at the Chicken House Auction, but I bet you one thing, you will find a bargain. Won't you?
I sure will.
At Grant, after you cut your over, Jamie Cooper.
You got more than that?
I sure will.
Meet Dee Williams, her husband Jim, Brother Frank, son Scotty, daughter Tarina and pets, Mai Tai and Snuffy. Typical family, right? Not exactly, especially when you meet the newest member of the Williams household, Poindexter, a four-week-old, full-blooded, house-trained pig.
It's nose. Want a bridle?
I got off.
Making a pig of himself is an understatement when you consider the Williams live in a mobile home. Actually, Poi, as they call him, has the run of the place. Dee, it seems, had a pig as a child, and James Morrison, a childhood friend, saw to it she got another.
They didn't really think I'd get it, I don't think. And I didn't really think they would accept it. But sure enough, they did. They treated it just like the dog or the cat or anything else, you know.
Well, actually, they're smarter and cleaner than dogs. They don't get into the fish aquarium like the cat does. It's a pet.
The family has adapted quite well to sharing their home with a rooter. The only time Poi really raises a stink is when he gets his feet washed. Yeah. Poi eats about everything except collard greens and chocolate, and he should grow to about 600 pounds. Talk about hogging the couch.
Not little Poi here winds up on the dinner table. Well, only time will tell, along with the appetites of the people he lives with, but talk about being in hog heaven. Sorry about the lights. In Lacey Spring, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper. Your eyes feel better now?
Grover Cleveland was our 24th president when Ella Bessie Holderfield was born in Lawrence County. Today, 100 years later, Ella Holderfield, still in Lawrence County, just celebrated her 100th birthday. One of 13 kids and the only one living, Miss Holderfield recalls living a rough life as a child.
Well, I had one dress. And I went to school a little. I didn't never get to go much, just went a little. And I'd wear that dress and go to school, and I'd come back and hang it up, wash it and hang it up, wear it back next day. I thought, I don't want a hat. Didn't have there nothing.
Entertainment was slim and none for Miss Holderfield growing up. Dating was out of the question. She married at 14.
I was a virgin when I married. And I don't know, I just had to learn as a man.
Was it fun?
Part of it was. Scared the fire out of it.
You did what?
Scared the fire out of it. I was just a little old girl, I didn't know nothing.
You learned quick, didn't you?
Yeah.
I will say, you do not look a day over 80 to me. Anything you want to ask me?
You know, get me a date.
Get you a date?
Yeah.
I'll see if I can. In Cortland, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper. As long as he's got a good car, right?
Yeah.
That's right, $200 for the city of Madison. That's not a bad deal either, but not this town of Madison, this one. A replica of sorts of the way Madison was in the 1920s when 78-year-old Marion Taylor was growing up there.
There's a lot of difference now. There wasn't but one store down there when I grew up. And one blacksmith shop and a grist mill, church, and that, well, there was more, but one house on the street of Madison, but there was a few more houses.
Taylor started construction of his town back in the summer, and little by little it grew to resemble the hometown he recalls from some 60 to 70 years ago.
I was sitting down one day and I built one. I said, that looks just like the old Madison store, just like the one that the fellow run when I was living down there. And I built it, and then I said, well, I'll just build a shop. And I built a shop, then they had a big barn there, and I built it. Then they had the church, the little Baptist church out there, and I built it.
What's it like to own your own town?
Well, good to own your own town, but to be an old town, I'd rather have the old town as a new one. It makes me wish I was still back down there.
Most all the work on Taylor's Madison was done with a pocket knife. He would sell the town for $200. Still not a bad price for such a growing town.
Even though Marion Taylor owns his own town, he's still not quite satisfied.
He wishes things were the way they used to be when this was a real town. In Tony, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
Tomorrow will be one of the saddest days of Ann Caldwell's life. Tomorrow, Mrs. Caldwell and her husband, Paul, must sell a big part of what they've been pack ratting the past 42 years. The Caldwells purchased the historic Taylor's Emporium a year ago when they moved here to Geraldine from New Jersey. The rustic red building had the reputation of being a place to find the old and the unusual. The Caldwells just added to it. Because the lease is up and business hasn't been what it should, the Caldwells are auctioning off everything, from the antiquated plows to the galvanized dishpan.
Well, it means an awful lot to me now that I've been here a year. When I bought it, I was thrilled to death to get it because it was my kind of thing. And of course, now it's a heartbreak to have to give it up. It really does. It means an awful lot to me.
Make no doubt about it, the inventory to be found in Taylor's Emporium would be hard to match in these modern times. From fiddles to Indian artifacts, cash registers to wagon wheels, everything goes tomorrow. But it wouldn't if only Ann Caldwell had a bigger house. In Geraldine, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper. ...39-year-old Richard Tess got his driver's license in 1962. His dream, like a lot of young boys his age, was to own the best-looking car on the road. To Tess, that car was a 1963 Chevrolet. Well, Tess didn't get a 63 Chevy then, but he's got a yard full of them now. Tess, altogether, has 21 of his dream 63 Chevys here at his home in Limestone County, including this one-of-a-kind 63 Hurst. Combined, there are some 60 automobiles of different styles and makes surrounding his home, but it's the 63 Chevy that Tess loves the most.
What are you doing with so many 63 Chevrolets?
Well, they're my favorite car. I'd rather have it than any other car I know of.
Why?
Well, it's the car I started out wanting when I came of age to drive, and I just decided when I had a chance to buy one, I bought one, and from then I went on to bigger and better things, kept buying them, and will still buy them.
Are they worth anything?
They're worth everything to me, but I don't know if they're worth too much to anybody else.
The 63s of Richard Tess aren't exactly what you would call show car quality, and rust has replaced the shiny new paint jobs the cars once had. But in the eyes of Richard Tess, the 63 Chevys are a dream come true.
Richard Tess hasn't drug in a new 63 Chevrolet in 4 or 5 years now, but that's only because he hasn't been able to find what he's looking for. In Limestone County, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
That's it, you got a smile. Stan Miller will be in the Super Bowl Sunday. He won't actually be playing in the game, but he will be part of the Super Bowl festivities. Miller and his family have been getting the car ready for months to make the trip. It's because of the car that Miller is going to the Super Bowl. Buick is this year's official car of the NFL, and Miller's Buick happens to be quite a showpiece. The car, a 1962 Buick Convertible Deluxe Special, will be one of 22 from 1909 to 1962 invited to participate in the Super Bowl parade. Miller's car is the only one from Alabama, and has been in his family since the day it was bought.
It probably has more sentimental value than monetary because it's a one-family car. It was my grandfather's car. He bought it brand new in Winter Haven, Florida back in 1962. And through the years, it's been passed on and I've inherited it and taken the interest and the time and the resources required. And along with some folks in Huntsville and some grand neighbors, we've put it back together to the car it is today.
The 22 Classic Buicks are scheduled to carry a MVP from a previous Super Bowl.
Who are you pulling for?
In this particular game, I'm somewhat undivided. I guess I'll pull for Chicago. I'm really a Redskin fan.
Sing that song for me.
Hail to the Redskins, hail victory. Braves on the warpath, fight for ODC.
I don't think Walter Payton and the refrigerator are going to be singing much of that down there.
I don't think so. They've already got their own song called the Super Bowl Shuffle.
So you're going to have a good time even without the Redskins?
We sure hope so.
Well, good luck.
Thank you much.
I like your car.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
And what'd you say? What?
Out of San Antonio built this motor.
Junior McClanahan and Darrell Huckabee are probably two guys you've never heard of.
but in their sport, they could be classified as a John Hanna or a Refrigerator Perry. These guys are pullers, big time. McClanahan and Huckleby are in Decatur for this weekend's National Outlaw Showdown Tractor Pull.
McClanahan's truck, a 1980 Chevy pickup, isn't exactly what you'd call ordinary.
Well, it's one of the few in the nation that the bed will tilt up like it does, and this truck itself does not have a regular pickup frame underneath it. It's all homemade. It was built from scratch.
Valued at $75,000 and a 1,000-horsepower engine, McClanahan's truck Fantasy is a definite crowd-pleaser. Huckleby's truck, on the other hand, is quite ordinary. And except for the fact that his 79 Peterbilt has a 1,100 cubic inch motor and over 900,000 miles, Huckleby's truck is no different than others on the road. Huckleby delivers such things as potatoes during the week and performs on the weekend.
Oh, I just think it's a great sport, you know, and everybody likes it. Grown-ups, kids, everybody likes it.
These trucks, along with a lot of other ones, will be putting on their own version of the Super Bowl. And you can bet that the version here in Decatur will be a lot louder than the one in New Orleans. Hit it! In Decatur, have you cut your rover?
Lewis Coppinger and Clint Eastwood have one thing in common. They both know how to work with a piece of hickory. Coppinger spent a large part of his life managing the Sasquatchie Handleworks in Sasquatchie, Tennessee, which happens to be part of the largest handle-producing company in the world. Producing some 12,000 handles a day here, everything from sledge, pick, claw, and hatchet, the Sasquatchie Handleworks has been in business since 1899. According to Coppinger, the hickory handles made by Sasquatchie have also had their share of fame.
Lester Maddox, I think we helped him be elected governor of Georgia by using our axe handles.
The Sasquatchie starred with Clint Eastwood in Pale Rider. Coppinger claims the average tool wears out 6 handles in a lifetime, and 98% of all handles go for replacements.
Now, handles certainly aren't the most glamorous product in the world, but they are essential. Have you ever tried to cut wood without one?
Well, there's nothing like a nice piece of hickory.
This is Sasquatchie, Tennessee. Have you got your rover?
Much Jamie obliged. Here.
Gerald Weems just loves to slave over a hot stove, especially when that hot stove happens to be a genuine Red Mountain tea. Weems, a Decatur police officer, and his wife, Doris, spend plenty of supper time hours during these cold days around the old-fashioned wood stove. Bought for around $10 some 12 years ago, the wood stove has been worth $1 million in not only the taste of country cooking, but in the memories of a time before electricity when an identical stove would have been considered a luxury.
My mother had one when I was growing up, and we used to come here from the field, and she'd cook supper on it, and then we would eat supper, but she'd always go milk a cow after she cooked, and then we'd sit down and eat supper. But she always had a wood stove when I was growing up.
Can you taste any difference in the food?
I believe so. What it made just be nostalgia of it, made it be the fun of doing it and the remembrances of childhood there, but it tastes better.
Isn't it a pain to work with at times?
Yeah, sometimes when the wind's in the wrong direction, the draft's not right, and it won't work right. Smoke the house up, you have to shut it off.
The wood stove isn't the only stove in the Weems kitchen. An electric one sits practically idle in winter months, and an additional wood stove is outside for summer fish fries.
In the heart and stomach of Gerald Weems, nothing, not even a microwave, will ever replace his beloved wooden stove. Ain't it good?
Yeah.
Thank you, too.
Real good.
Indicator on your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
This 1200, what is 10% of what number?
Math can be confusing these days for high school students, especially for students like these at Crossville High School, who occasionally get a double dose of confusion from math teacher Samuel Hayes.
Since you, if you want to work this upside backwards, you go 725 is, means equal, 8% is what? 0.08.
Hayes, for some strange reason, is capable of explaining mathematical equations upside down and backwards, as well as the normal way. But for Hayes, this is normal. Not only math problems, but the 59-year-old teacher can write equally as good right-handed or left-handed, upside down or backwards, at the same time. It's something he says he was just born with.
It's been confusing at times.
Probably so. To some of the kids, anyway.
But not
to me. No, it's perfectly. I can read it written backward as easy as I can read it forward.
According to most of his classes, Mr. Hayes is not your ordinary, everyday teacher, and things do get quite confusing in here from time to time. What you writing here, Mr. Hayes?
Heather Burns is our favorite TV person.
Thanks. More confusing than I thought. You're Crossville High School in Crossville. I'm your country rover. Now you can do it. Thank you.
Bill Green has been in the radiator repair business the past 20 years, but always in the back of his mind, practically ever since he was singing in the cotton fields, Green has wanted to be a country singer and have his own record playing on the radio. Now, recording a record and repairing radiators is entirely two different animals, but Bill Green was determined, and now the 46-year-old Athens radiator repairman has his first record. Green will be the first to admit he may never appear on the national network or sell a million copies, but he would, very quick-like, trade the radiator business for singing.
Would you give up the radiator business if somebody from Nashville called?
Sure would. And a New York mini.
Green's biggest supporter and number one fan is his wife, Jane. She loves the record, both sides, Dreaming Again and I Can't Leave Your Memory Behind.
Would you buy one of his records?
Yeah, I bought 500 of them.
For Bill Green, this record is a dream come true. And if it's not successful, he'll just try it again. In Athens, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper. For some 7 or 8 years now, the folks of Russellville have had a special day to celebrate the 1st of February. That day is Groundhog Day. And this year, unlike the previous ones when participants were many, only one of the furry little critters known as a groundhog showed up. 83-year-old Lewis Bendel also showed up, and he says groundhogs are practically good for nothing.
Are they worth anything?
Not a penny in the world. They're harmless. They'll eat up your garden, watermelons, cantaloupes, maters, everything.
The groundhog may be good for nothing, but for the Colonial Bank of Russellville, the groundhog is a welcome sight.
Just something to sort of beat the after-holiday doldrums. You know, there's nothing else going on, and a lot of people seem to enjoy it. And we don't have much else to do down here, so we thought we'd push for a national groundhog holiday, and we're going to introduce a bill in the legislature real soon, we think.
I want to give you all this $100 prize. And Ms. Coburn, I think you...
Travis Coburn, a previous two-time winner, won the $100 prize for having this year's biggest groundhog, and also the only one.
You want him to move?
Yeah, make him move.
Give me a pencil.
Well, stick your finger
give me
out.
That
use your finger.
I'll use my pocket knife. Get away.
I thought you said these things were practically good for nothing.
They are good for something.
It was good enough for $100 for you today, wasn't it? It was good enough for $100 for you today.
Yeah, that's right.
You can buy a lot of groundhog with that, can't you?
Yeah.
In Russell, it's National Groundhog Day, every country rover, Jamie Cooper. Let me just use my finger.
All right, go ahead and use it.
He's about to get mad.
You look at that.
68-year-old P.I. Posey of Haleyville has earned a well-known reputation over the years as being somewhat of a bad dude. If you don't believe me, just ask him.
Could be rough as a cow. I could be rough, but I ain't. I'm a good guy. I don't get mad at nobody. I can't get mad.
P.I. Posey is known for his knife handling. And please, don't try any of the things you're about to see Posey demonstrate.
Got it? Mm-hmm. All right. Now you want me to cut it off with two or three?
Yeah. Yeah.
Actually, Posey, who says he was once a British commando, is a knife slinger, and a good one at that.
Well, I tell you what, in 1/10 of 1 second, I move as fast as a rifle bullet. A rifle can't shoot no faster. In other words, if I was to mine too, I could have my one knife stuck up his barrel and split that bullet in two before he could even pull the trigger.
So you the Billy Kid of knives?
Well, if you want to call me anything, but Billy Kid was slow beside me.
P.I. Posey said that when he was young, he was real fast. And he's been told that Jim Bowie was nothing compared to what he is today. Draw.
Right. Draw that.
And you know, I believe him. You're a dangerous man, Mr. Posey, and quite fast. In Haleyville, I'm your catcher over. Jamie Cooper, you could be a dangerous man.
Yeah, I could be, but I...
That's Mama's baby, big man. Cute.
For most of her life, Pat Emerson has always had somewhat of an unusual pet. To Pat, pets like George just aren't unusual.
Let's go, George, go.
Now, Big Man and Maggie May are pets just like you and I might have, and that's it for ordinary. Pat Emerson's most beloved pet is Rojo, a 2-year-old, half-cock, half-Rhode Island Red.
You know that, too. Oh, there's George.
Now, roosters like Rojo may be a dime a dozen in these parts, but where else can you find a rooster that, supposedly, not only can crow on command, but sing and dance as if his feet were in the Colonel's skillet?
Rojo, crow for Mama! Crow, Rojo! Put on the lid. Mama's gonna make a little cornbread. Mama's here, baby. Let's be nuts, Mama. Boy, he can sing. Sing, Rojo. Sing. Sing, Rojo. Sing. Sing, Rojo. Sing.
Stupid singing to a
chicken.
So you can talk to all animals, and animals understand you. They do me.
Mama, come on, darling. Crow for Mama.
Rojo may not be one to crow about how good he is, but he does rule the roost here.
Crow. Crow, Rojo.
In Meridianville, I'm your country rover, James River. Crow.
That's Mama's baby.
Now, don't bite hard. Don't bite me hard or I won't come and see you. No.
Carolyn Roberts has a somewhat exotic taste when it comes to her pets. She could be called the cat woman. Miss Roberts' pets consist of a cougar, a couple of leopards,
Cheater.
And a few tigers.
Oh, he feels good because it's cold.
Having raised these cats since they were 3 to 4 days old, Miss Roberts is practically the only mother they've ever known.
We are animal people. We just love any type of animal, be it exotic or just your domestic cat and dog. We just love animals.
Aren't they dangerous?
Yes, they are dangerous. They are not for everyone.
Inside the Roberts home is where the most petted of the large kittens calls home, Sheba. Sheba, an 11-week-old Bengal tiger, also has a brother the Roberts have. Well, Sheba is like the rest of the animals. Housebroken?
We can bring those cats into the home and place litter boxes to their convenience, and they will use them and not have an accident. But a tiger is a little harder to housebreak. If she bites you, she won't bite you home.
Maybe not all today. Now, Sheba only weighs about 28 pounds right now. 2 years, she's going to weigh about 400.
You sure you got something to eat?
He's getting paid. I'm going to eat you.
Manhattan, I'm your country rover. They may not look like cowboys to you, but in a sense they are. They're cowboys of a different sort, participating in a somewhat new sport, tire changing.
Valve stems must be lubricated. Failure to do so will result in 5 seconds.
Last week in Cullman, some 15 so-called concrete cowboys gathered to compete against one another and the clock to see who could change a passenger tire on a tire changing machine the fastest.
It gives them motivation to learn more about their product. It teaches them the correct and the wrong way to change tires and how to handle every situation where there won't be damage done to your tire and your wheel. Oh, not anybody nowadays can't change a tire. It's something that you have to have machines to do it and you have to have the knowledge to do it.
The winner here was to advance to the state finals in Birmingham. From there, the winner goes to the national finals in Las Vegas and a chance to become the national tire changing champion.
Speed. That's all it is to it. Speed and not panicking.
Now, I doubt quite seriously if tire changing rodeo ever catches on as a major sporting event, but if you have a flat one night, you're going to wish you had one of these cowboys riding with you, right?
Right.
Cullen at McGriff Tires. Have your cut your over, Jamie Cooper. Which one are y'all gonna call when I leave?
Pick up on 17. That's one you've already had to do.
Okay. Classes last week at Scottsboro High School weren't quite the same. Some of the new old students were the center of attention. Students like Barbara Strain, Olivia Brewer, and Cactus Gay were just a few of some 130 parents who substituted for their kids for a day. It's part of a unique program to let parents learn more about what their kids actually go through in school.
Just want our parents to come in and see what goes on in a day of the lives of our school kids. And, you know, they don't know what it is to hit the halls simultaneously with 970-something other students and try to get from an English class on one end of the building to a PE class or a home ec class on the other end of the building.
The parents who participated had to go through the day without any special privileges. For some, that created small problems.
And she didn't give me her locker number and a combination, so she said that's the way they do it in school, so she wrote it on my hand.
Hit it!
1959, Scottsboro graduate Cactus Gay fulfilled all his daughter's school activities, including cheerleading practice. Even though one parent got caught with a cigarette and several were caught in the bathroom without a pass, and I think a few were late for class, all in all, it was a learning experience for everyone. And no one got a paddling. Aren't you glad?
Certainly am.
But you could put it on them, couldn't you?
I don't know.
Scottsboro High School, have your country rover, Jamie Cooper. For 30 years, 63-year-old Coy Clem has had a long walk to work. Rain, sleet, or snow ever kept Clem from making his way to his occupation. Since 1956, when Clem first started, till last Friday, 30 years to the day, Coy Clem was the bridge tender at the state's only drawbridge, the Keller Memorial in Decatur.
Highway Bridge, Port Decatur on 13. Highway Bridge, Port Decatur on 13. All in all, it's a good job. In the wintertime, it's rough when it gets down around zero. But otherwise, in the summertime, it's pretty hectic when you got all these sailboats going through here, especially on Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday.
Clem's office would rival almost anyone's when it came to scenery. His office, a very small, compact room without luxuries, perched above the Tennessee River, is where Clem spent the majority of his time. Clem claims that bridge tending is the perfect job for someone who likes to be alone.
It depends on where you can stay by yourself or not. I can stay by myself, it doesn't bother me, but a lot of people can't.
River traffic as well as highway traffic has increased over the years. 3 decades ago, the bridge was raised no more than 10 times a month.
Today, it's about 350 times a month. And Coy Clem, who has two sons who are also bridge tenders, has seen his share of them.
In the 30 years that Coy Clem has been the bridge tender here, only one car has gone into the Tennessee River. The 53 Buick is still there. Indicator, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
Sing me a song of the cowboy as he rides o'er hill and dale.
It's been years since Gene Autry rode across the silver screen in theaters, but thanks to Jesse Rush, Gene Autry and other cowboy greats like him are riding again in the American Cowboy Heroes Museum.
The first movie that I saw that Gene in was called Red River Valley. And Gene was riding champion across the screen, had his guitar singing a song, and I thought that was the grandest thing I'd ever seen before. And I've remembered that all through the years.
64-year-old Rush has been collecting cowboy memorabilia, mostly Autry, ever since he was a kid. Today, his collection includes hundreds of old movies and TV shows, thousands of records, pictures, and collectible items. Rush's lifelong assemblage of the American Cowboy can be seen starting Saturday in the American Cowboy Heroes Museum, located in the Boaz Outlet Shopping Center. The museum, the only one of its kind, was established to give husbands something to do while their wives shop the popular Boaz Outlet, but mainly, let us all relive a little of our childhood.
If I'd had one wish to come true, I would love to have been a cowboy like Gene Autry. And I guess I'd still like to be a cowboy, really.
You know, it's hard to sing and be mean at the same time.
Cowboys like Tom Mix, Roy Rogers, Gene Autry, and Hopalong Cassidy, well, cowboys like that that we grew up with will never die, thanks to real cowboys like Jesse Rush. In Boaz, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper. It wasn't exactly a scene from the Old West, but a posse of Boaz police officers delivered, almost on time, a real-life cowboy to kick off the opening of the American Cowboy Heroes Museum. 68-year-old Pat Buttram never was known for being a gunslinger. He never killed anyone, or for being a Western Romeo. Buttram's claim to fame was being Gene Autry's sidekick.
Oh, no, she ain't. I'm first, and here's my dollar.
Shoot 50 times out of a gun and only held 6 bullets, but I never killed a man or kissed a girl in a Western picture.
We left you out all the way around, didn't we?
Well,
break it up, break it up. All right, break it up.
Buttram from Haleyville, Alabama, made some 40 movies with Autry, but you might remember him best for playing the lovable con man,
howdy,
Mr. Haney, on Green
You're
Acres.
The proprietor of this here Green Acres Inn?
No, I am your mine host and innkeeper, Eustace Haney.
Comparison to like a real person in Haleyville to Mr. Haney, would it be?
Listen, you know how many people you've got right here in Boaz that are Mr. Haney's. This state is full of them.
The good news for you Green Acres fans are that they're planning a reunion as soon as they can find a replacement for Arnold. Is that right?
That's right. We're still looking. I get paid for this, man. How much?
Little Mr. Haney rubbed off on you, didn't it? In Boaz at the American Heroes Cowboy Museum. I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper. That's a nice hat you got there, too.
I'll sell you this hat.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you?
Fine. How are you, sure?
14 years, Cheryl Shanafeld Hale has been a barber. Not a hairdresser or stylist, just a barber. Cheryl spends most of her time these days cutting hair, mostly men's, at her own barbershop in Hartsel, Cheryl's Barbershop. Besides the fact that this is just a barbershop that employs all women, customers at Cheryl's often get an added treat at no additional cost.
Now I'm a woman sleeping all alone, sleeping single in a double bed, tossing, turning, trying to forget. I could be lying here with you instead. I'm sleeping single in a double bed.
How about that, Mr.
Mack? Oh, that's right. You're singing to me, I guess.
Cheryl Hale wants to be a big-time country singer. Since Christmas Eve, she's been singing weekly on the Country Boy Eddie Show in Birmingham.
I think I'm pretty doggone good.
What about as a haircutter?
I'm great as a haircutter. I love myself, I guess, but I do feel like I have a very good business, and I think I cut hair extremely well.
Cheryl will be the first to tell you, folks don't come to her barbershop to hear her sing. They come to get a haircut.
A good-hearted woman in love with a good time in
If day. Things go right for Cheryl, she'll be cutting records instead of cutting hair. And then things just won't be the same here at Cheryl's barbershop. That's what I like. In Hartsville, Cheryl's barbershop, I'm your country rapper, Jamie Cooper.
With a good time in
May. All right.
Plan.
Claudia Watkins took her first dip of snuff when she was 9 years old, and that was 109 years ago in 1877. Today, at 118, Claudia Watkins is still going strong when it comes to dipping.
Yeah, since I was nine, been dipping, but my grandma took away from it.
You remember when you took your first snuff, first dip of snuff?
Yeah, I remember because my grandma told me up.
Claudia Watkins was born in Morgan County 2 years after the Civil War ended in 1867. 3 months from now, June 15th, Claudia Watkins will celebrate her 119th birthday. Of her 18 children, seven are still living. One is 103. The one thing Claudia remembers most about her childhood is the whoopings she got. They were nothing like what children get today.
Kids today don't get many weapons, do they?
No.
Do they
get a bell, flam, flam. It ain't been more hurt than when you hurt that tree out there.
What should you help them with?
Switches.
Here, you need this?
I don't think I'll have one right now. I'll pass.
So what?
That smells pretty good, isn't it?
Yeah. Sure is.
Ed Hustle, I'm your country rover.
Yeah.
Jamie Cooper, I bet you dip more snuff than anybody in the United States.
Oh, yes, I know I do.
I bet you do.
I do.
Vicki Cockrell's no Barbara Mandrell or Loretta Lynn, but when she sings her country music, she's got sugar on her side. Sugar Boy, an 11-year-old, your guess is as good as mine, dog, has been harmonizing with the Tom Haney Band and his owner, Miss Cockrell, the past 3 years. Sugar, who, like Alabama, doesn't read any music, knows exactly when to sing, especially when it's his favorite song.
Let me sing. One more.
I would sing or something, I would say, well, it's your turn to sing, Sugar, come on and help me. And he finally picked it up. He just don't like to be laughed at.
Who would you compare him to in country music?
Tom T. Hall or Bill Anderson or somebody like that.
Is that good, huh?
Oh, he's great. Well,
Sugar. They're left with us.
Not me. Your life don't care because it's over, Jamie Cooper. I like to sing
it. When the country music makers of Lexington get together to pick a little tune, you can bet their banjo player is the first one ready. Emma Hammonds first strummed on a banjo when she was 9 years old. That was 83 years ago. Today, at a spry 92, Ms. Emma continues to play with the best of them. Ms. Emma got her first banjo from her brother by trading a hen and a rooster for it. 20 years ago, she picked enough cotton to buy a new one. And through all her banjo picking days, she's never used to pick.
How come you don't use a pick?
I don't want no pig. I can use my fingers without a pig.
You can?
Why, sure.
Are you a pretty good banjo player?
Huh?
Are you a pretty good banjo picker?
Well, I don't know whether I am or not. Some of them says I am, sure. Some of them I don't
know. Miss Emma says that even if Nashville were to call tomorrow, she'd just have to turn them down. She doesn't like to travel, but she does love her banjo. Hit it. Pretty good. In Lexington, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
If there's one thing Ira Standridge knows, it's baskets. For 47 years, Standridge and his family have been producing baskets at the Nectar Basket Factory in Blount County. Using nothing but poplar trees from nearby sawmills, the logs are sliced into splits that in turn turn into baskets of all sizes. All the basket making is done by some 15 local folks who weave about 250 dozen baskets a day.
And that's all I could. If you did not decide and watch what you're doing, trim it good, you got a good basket.
You think you make a good basket?
Oh, no, I do. That will do. Put out a good one.
Not only does the Nectar Basket Factory sell to local peach growers, but folks from just about everywhere come here to purchase the handmade craft baskets.
It's a nice place to come to get all the kind of different kinds of baskets you want.
So it's worth the drive from Arkansas.
You better believe it.
The Nectar Basket Factory has in stock some 5,000 dozen baskets and is open 6 days a week, just in case you're running late for Easter.
They make about 15 different varieties of baskets here at the Nectar Basket Factory, the newest being the picnic basket and the bassinet. And you really don't have to be a basket case to shop here, though at times it might help. Right? Happy Easter. In Nectar, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
Robert Curry took on a part-time job as a dinner theater waiter a year ago. He's been quite successful.
Very good servant.
Is he a pretty good waiter?
Yes, he is.
Best in the house.
Waiting on tables is just a sideline for Curry, however. In his full-time job, Curry is president of the First National Bank of Pulaski, Tennessee. Things aren't going that bad at the bank, but quite the opposite, they're that good. The Pulaski Dinner Theater, where Curry works, is actually in the basement of the First National Bank. And all the food, from the steamship round to the boiled shrimp, was prepared and served by bank employees. Your good man Charlie Brown was the fifth play presented by the bank. All have been sellouts in the 100-seat theater. And the $25,000 raised has all gone to charity.
We just needed some innovative idea to try to get the people into our bank. We take the position and get people to visit us three times, we ought to make a customer out of them.
Bank teller Bobby Townsend, like a lot of his co-workers, doubles as an entertainer.
The bank, by doing this, gives people in the community a chance to come and get out and enjoy something that they usually don't get to normally do around this area.
This was the last performance in the bank basement. The bank is building a community room to seat 300.
It may not be Broadway, but it's the next best thing here in Pulaski, and a big tip doesn't necessarily guarantee a big loan,
or does it?
Well, it will help.
In Pulaski, Tennessee, every country rover, Jamie Cooper. You're doing a good job.
Thank you so much.
76-year-old Thomas Bracken and Alabama lead singer Randy Owen have one thing in common, that they were both at last year's Alabama June Jam.
What are you going to see here today?
I see some music mostly.
You're not looking for women, are you?
Well, I ain't saying I'm not.
I don't know for sure if Mr. Bracken will be one of the 50,000 or so country music fans attending June Jam number 5, but I do know Randy Owen will be there along with some other mighty fine entertainers.
Well, this is going to be, this should be, it has to be, the biggest, of all. Willie Nelson, Waylon Jennings, Mel Tillis, the Forrester Sisters, Gary Morris, Alabama, and Alabama. And so far we don't have a definite no on Lionel Richie, but you know, he hasn't said yes either, so.
Last year's jam attracted an estimated 55,000 country music fans to the 40-acre former hayfield. There's no reason to believe that this year's crowd won't be even bigger.
Now, you know, we're going to tell you that this year's June Jam is going to be the biggest and best ever, isn't that right?
Absolutely.
That's June the 14th.
June the 14th. Vern, let's see, will Vern be there? So the other guy's Vern.
You know? You know what I mean, anyway. June the 14th, be here, Fort Payne, for the June Jam. In Fort Payne with Randy Owen, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper. How come I can't ever see
you? You could.
Oh, really?
You can be there.
I'm going to be there.
You want to introduce who you want to introduce?
I don't know.
12 years ago, Dave Jr. Mann was a young farmer with a big ambition to follow in his father's and grandfather's footsteps and be a successful farmer. A week ago, that ambition ended.
Now $8 be able to give 8, able to give 8, 7, and $8 went down to give 8, so Joe White, $7, sorry sir, we missed you, $7.
A familiar sight on farms across America these days is the farm auction. Dave Jr.'s was another. Fellow farmers and strangers alike gathered in a field near downtown New Hope last Saturday to view and check out the used merchandise that was once part of a young man's dream, a dream shattered by high prices. A bushel of beans when Dave Jr. started farming sold for almost $9 a bushel. Last year, they sold for under $5 a bushel, while at the same time, the price of farm machinery had quadrupled.
You always feel for them, especially when they hadn't made any money in the last 4 or 5 years. You got a feeling where they just finally give up hope. And it's you have a feeling they will sell you go to.
The unfortunate thing about an auction like this one, some of the folks buying here will be experiencing the same thing sooner or later. Young farmers like Dave Jr. have time to do something else. For older farmers who've done nothing else for a lifetime, well, they may have nothing else to do.
Farm auctions like this one are becoming quite common around these parts, and though they are somewhat of a sad occasion, they're also becoming a way of life for today's farmers. In New Hope, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.
I ain't been washing on that. No.
Mary and Eddie Bird live life the old-fashioned way, and most luxuries as we know them haven't found their way to the Bird household, and even if they had, the Birds probably wouldn't even use them.
Oh, you talking about how long you been washing that pot? I said, that pot, old. That pot, 100 years old or more. Yeah.
Mary Bird is a firm believer in hard work. Most of her 82 years has been spent doing nothing but that. There are no complaints from Miss Bird, just signs of years of wear and tear.
I used to wash them with a rubber boat and rub them in a tub. We didn't have them kind of washing machines. We had tubs and rubber boats.
If Mary Bird has a complaint, it's about folks who are just plain lazy. Folks like you and me.
Washes and dries is for lazy folk. That's the person don't want to do nothing.
That's not you, is it?
It's not me.
And people today are lazy?
I said, a wash and a dry was for lazy folks.
Mary Bird will soon have her own washer and dryer hooked up. Even then, I doubt if she'll be lazy, too. Wednesday night, Eddie Bird, a plowing professional. In Tuscumbia, I'm your country rover, Jamie Cooper.